Good afternoon, good morning to everyone who's joining us today. Welcome to Baker Donaldson's first labor and employment webinar series that's focused entirely on the healthcare industry. I'm Jennifer Curry. I am an employment attorney I focus on advising and defending healthcare providers. And I am joined by my colleague, Tom Barnard here, who will introduce himself.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tom Barnard. I focus on defending healthcare providers and practices from government investigations and inquiries and subpoenas of that like. So I think together, Jennifer and I kind of try to cover a full gamut of information.
So just to take care of some housekeeping issues to start, we do have a Q&A box, so any questions that come up during the presentation, if we can fit them in and answer them, we will get to those. We also will have a survey at the end of the webinar that we would really appreciate that you fill out. For anybody looking for a copy of the presentation after it is done, we will have a PDF of the presentation that will be emailed out to anybody who attended. And then we also, you know, invite you to connect with Baker Donaldson on our social media links. We have links both in Twitter and on LinkedIn. So to get started, we'll move on. What is our agenda? So we're going to be focusing today on the obligations of healthcare providers who are federal contractors. Our main focus will be on the OFCCP, how you might fall within the OFCCP's jurisdiction, whether you have affirmative action obligations, and what's on the horizon under the new administration. Tom's then going to jump in with why this topic matters to you and options you have as it relates to compliance. So our first poll today is, to which U.S. government agency does the OFCCP belong? If anybody wants to take a stab at that. So let's see what we got. DOL. All right. Everybody, for the most part, we had correct responses here. That is right. The OFCCP is the Office of Federal Contract Compliance Programs, and it is a unit within the U.S. Department of Labor. It audits federal contractors and subcontractors to ensure compliance with their affirmative action obligations, and it has the power to investigate complaints of discrimination. They also have the authority issued both monetary and non-monetary awards for any violations that they find. So there are three applicable laws that OFCCP is responsible for enforcing. Executive Order 11246, Section 503 of the Rehabilitation Act, and the Vietnam-era Veterans Readjustment Assistance Act, or VEVRA. Together, these three laws cover the basic areas of discrimination that we all tend to think of, like race, color, religion, sex, national origin, and disability, but they also cover sexual orientation, gender identity, and disabled veterans. So our next poll, how many of the attendees today have federal contracts? Let's see our results. Oh, okay. So we have almost half of you do have federal contractors, and about 40% of you say you don't. Let's just talk about who exactly is a government contractor. So a contractor is somebody that does, or an organization that does business directly with the federal government, an agency of the federal government. A subcontractor is an organization that does business indirectly with an agency of the federal government. So if you have a contract, let's say, for example, with the VA, or you work for another organization that has a contract with the VA providing goods and services to that organization in fulfilling its obligations to the VA, you are a federal subcontractor.
Hey, Jennifer.
Yeah.
Maybe just talk briefly. You and I have both seen in the last couple months a number of people who think they're not government contractors, and it turns out they actually are, because they're not sure or they're not aware of some of the smaller contracts and things. Talk about that dynamic and how, even though you may not think of yourself as one, you could be one.
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of contracts, even small contracts that you might have with a variety of federal agencies, and it might not be necessarily related to a healthcare agency. It could be the Consumer Protection Services agency. It could be, like I said, the VA. It could be Homeland Security. It could be the Department of Defense. There's a variety of different kinds of contracts that you might have, or one of your subsidiaries might have, or that somebody might have signed without you even knowing, that actually make you a federal contractor or a federal subcontractor. One of the best ways to test that out is to go to usaspending.gov, or there's a federal procurement data site that you can plug in your entity's name and will tell you if there are any federal contracts out there with your name on it and how much those are valued at. So moving on, let's talk about contractors who are subject to Executive Order 11246. If any business or organization that holds a single federal contract, a subcontract, or a federally assisted construction contract in excess of $10,000, or if you have a combination of those in excess of $10,000 in any 12-month period. The second law under Section 503, it's any business or organization that holds a single federal contract, subcontract, or federally assisted construction contract in excess of $10,000. And then finally, under VEVRA, it's any business or organization that has a contract or subcontract in excess of $100,000, or if you have an old contract that is still ongoing, it's dated before December 1st of 2013, and it's in excess of $25,000, then you are also covered. So for those of you who do believe you are federal contractors out there, or even if you're not, how many of you have affirmative action plans? So let's see our results. Great, that's great to see. So 85% answered that you do have affirmative action plans, which is good to know. An affirmative action plan is not required of all contractors or subcontractors. But let's first talk about as a federal contractor or subcontractor, you are required to prepare, publish, and maintain a written set of policies that state your compliance with the law. But when you see, as the chart shows here, if you have your larger entity or you have larger contracts, you're actually required to have an affirmative action plan. And it's something that you would implement to ensure that all of the qualified applicants and employees are receiving an equal opportunity for recruitment, selection, advancement, and every other term and privilege associated with employment. So for both EO 11246 and Section 503, an AAP is required to be used for employers with 50 or more employees and contracts worth more than $50,000. Under VEVRA, this applies to employers with 50 or more employees and contracts or subcontracts worth $150,000 or more. The biggest issue and probably the scariest issue out there is the single entity issue. So in many cases, healthcare providers are made of several different entities, including parents and subsidiaries. The big concern is, for example, if you have one of your smaller subsidiaries who signs a contract, does it make other subsidiaries or even the parent also a federal contractor? So the OFCCP has published a 26-factor test to determine whether two or more entities, whether it's two subsidiaries, a subsidiary and a parent, is a, quote, single entity. And if you are determined to be a single entity, not only is the organization that signed the federal contract or subcontract required to have affirmative action or follow affirmative action obligations, but so are the other entities who are within that single entity. Really, the single entity test is meant to determine whether those two or more entities should be treated as one entity for those obligations. So at its core, the test is really about the control maintained over the multiple entities. So do they have common ownership? Do they have common directors and officers? Do they, the same people, have day-to-day control over the policies, management, and supervision of the operations? Do they share a set of personnel policies? Are their operations dependent upon one another? So two entities don't necessarily, and these are just five examples, but the five core examples, and two entities don't have to satisfy all 26 of the factors that have been published by OFCCP, but they do just have to satisfy the majority. So can government healthcare, or can healthcare entities be covered government contractors? And the answer is a resounding yes. That's why we are here today. So how did we get to this point? How did the healthcare industry get here? So beginning in 2003, the OFCCP began aggressively pursuing jurisdiction over healthcare providers, which resulted in a trilogy of three big cases, starting with Bridgeport Hospital in Connecticut. So in that case, the Office of Personnel Management entered into a contract with Blue Cross Blue Shield, where Blue Cross agreed to provide reimbursement to OPM employees for medical services. And in exchange, OPM paid fixed premiums to Blue Cross worth more than $50,000. Now, Blue Cross then turned around and entered into a contract with Bridgeport Hospital. The hospital agreed to provide medical services to Blue Cross participants, and Blue Cross agreed to pay the hospital for those services. So then OFCCP comes knocking on the hospital's door, demanding Bridgeport's affirmative action plan. And in denying it was a federal contractor or subcontractor, Bridgeport refused to maintain any affirmative action plan or submit them in response to the OFCCP's audit notice. OFCCP then in turn filed an administrative complaint against Bridgeport, arguing that it was a federal covered subcontractor because it provided medical services or supplies to persons receiving the health care benefits under Blue Cross, and because Blue Cross had a prime contract with OPM. So the result, both the OFCCP and Bridgeport ended up filing motions for summary judgment in district court, before an administrative law judge, and the ALJ ruled in favor of the hospital, holding it was not a covered federal subcontractor. Specifically, Bridgeport held a reimbursement agreement with Blue Cross and paid Bridgeport a predetermined fee when it supplied particular medical services or supplies to federal employees covered by Blue Cross health insurance. So the ALJ held that this type of reimbursement agreement between Bridgeport and Blue Cross was not necessary for Blue Cross to actually fulfill its contractual obligation to OPM, nor did Bridgeport perform any portion of the Blue Cross OPM prime contract. So as a result, the ALJ sided with Bridgeport. The Administrative Review Board also upheld that decision. Let's back up one. So the takeaway essentially is in 2003, after that decision was issued, OFCCP issued what's called Directive 262 and actually admitted that it could not use healthcare provider relationships with federal employee healthcare participants to assert jurisdiction over a provider. Okay, so that's where we're starting with here in this trilogy. Then comes along UPMC Braddock. And in that case, it's a case against three University of Pittsburgh Medical Center hospitals, which included UPMC Braddock. And again, we have the OPM contracting with UPMC's health plan, which happened to be an HMO, The HMO agreed to provide medical products and services to OPM employees and their families. The HMO then lined up its network of participating providers to render that medical care. So OFCCP initiated a compliance audit against all three of the hospitals requesting their affirmative action plans on the premise that the hospitals were subcontractors to a direct contract between the federal OPM and the UPMC health plan. Obviously, the hospitals then denied that they were subcontractors, refused to submit any affirmative action plans. So the hospitals claimed that the prime contract between OPM and the HMO expressly excluded them from the definition of subcontract. So essentially, they had negotiated in the contract, there's a provision that says you're not going to be a federal subcontractor. And other conflicting provisions were also from the federal acquisition regulation sections were also kept out. So this went before an ALJ again, and the ALJ in this case took OFCCP's side, and that was upheld by the Administrative Review Board. The hospital then appealed to the U.S. District Court for the District of Columbia. The result is that the U.S. District Court affirmed the decision of the Administrative Review Board, determining that the direct contract between OPM and the HMO was an agreement to provide medical services. And in a lengthy, very lengthy examination of the nature of an HMO compared with an agreement to provide insurance services, the judge actually concluded that the party maintaining an HMO does more than just provide insurance services. It agrees to deliver medical care to federal employees. Therefore, the court determined the subcontractor hospital stands in the shoes of the direct contractor as a covered subcontractor when it too delivers medical services. Obviously, this is in contrast to the outcome of the Bridgeport case, where the agreement between Blue Cross and OPM was determined to be one for federal for insurance services only, and the hospital was found not to be a covered subcontractor. So the Braddock decision has been used by the OFCCP and to reinforce and also, frankly, remind just who is a federal subcontractor under the agency's regulations. So again, you know, we talked about this a little earlier, but a subcontract means any agreement or arrangement between a subcontractor and any person if the agreement is one for the purchase, sale, or use of personal property or non-personal services that's necessary to the performance of any one or more contracts. So that basically, you need to use a three-step analysis to determine whether you're a federal subcontractor. First, step one, identify the prime contract and the prime contractor. Step two, ask yourself, does the contract between the prime and the sub require the sub to provide any portion of the actual products or services required of the prime contractor? Or is the contract between the prime and sub necessary to the performance of the prime contract? And then step three, do you have 50 or more employees, and do you have one or more contracts worth a combined value of more than $50,000? So if you get through that three-step analysis and you answer yes to that final question, then you are a federal contractor or a federal subcontractor, and you're required to maintain an affirmative action plan. Let's bring us to our next poll question. Is your organization a Tricare subcontractor? Let's see the results. No, but we do have a few out there, and we do have a question about what is Tricare. Okay, so let's talk about what Tricare is. Tricare is the Department of Defense's healthcare program for uniformed service members and their families, and it is managed by the Defense Health Agency. The DoD has three direct contractors that administer the program. One is Humana Military Health System, two, TriWest, and three, HealthNet. These three contractors then in turn enter into contracts with hospitals and other healthcare providers to provide medical care and supplies to military personnel and their family members covered by Tricare. Let's see, and we do have actually a few questions. Okay, first one is a good question. If you don't mind, we'll just take a pause here. If you receive federal funds under a federal grant, will that make the entity a federal contractor? No. Grants are specifically or expressly exempted from federal contractor status. So if you are a federal if you are getting federal grants, you are not a federal contractor.
However, I mean, it doesn't necessarily relate to this presentation, but the grant itself, there may be conditions on it that you would want to evaluate under kind of a separate analysis, that they may incorporate things in the terms of the grant.
And then the other question I have here, if you could just give me 1 minute, is what is the federal procurement website that lists federal contractors? Just give me 1 minute and I can actually get that for everybody. That is www.fp, as in Paul, D as in David, S as in Sam, .gov. And it's a little wonky looking when you get into it, but there is a search box at the top that has looks a little bit like Google. And if you just type your entity's name in to that search box, it will tell you, it will bring up all contracts that have your entity's name in it. It will also tell you the date of the contract, who the contract is with, the value of the contract, and any amendments or renewals of that contract. So it can be very useful. Now, I'm not going to guarantee that is the end-all be-all of what might be out there, but it is a good place to start if you want to at least check up on whether or not there's anything out there with your entity's name on it. So now that we know what, I have a question, hold on. Want the federal procurement website one more time. It is www.f as in Frank, P as in Paul, D as in David, S as in Sam.gov. Okay. So this brings us to the last in the trilogy of the OFCCP cases, and that's OFCCP versus Florida Hospital of Atlanta, or I'm sorry, of Orlando. In this case, Tricare contracted with Humana Military Healthcare Services. That's one of the program managers that we just mentioned. And Humana agreed to enroll patients, manage referrals, process claims, provide customer service, underwrite healthcare costs, and this is the big piece, establish networks of providers. So Tricare, in turn, then agreed to pay Humana for its services. And Humana then contracted with Florida Hospital of Orlando to provide healthcare services for Tricare beneficiaries and agreed to pay the hospital approximately $100,000 for those services. And then OFCCP comes knocking at Florida Hospital's door with a demand for a desk and on-site audit of the hospital. Florida Hospital denies that OFCCP has jurisdiction, does not comply with the audit, and so the OFCCP files an administrative complaint against the hospital. So we have an ALJ, again, deciding the case, and the ALJ here initially concluded that hospitals that participate in the TRICARE program are subcontractors because they assume the performance of part of the program manager's obligation in its contract with the Department of Defense. So in other words, Florida Hospital was a subcontractor because it assumed the performance of at least part of Humana's obligations in its contract with Tricare. So the ALJ then also concluded that Tricare payments were not federal financial assistance payments and thus were subject to regulatory obligations applicable to federal contracts and subcontracts. So, of course, Florida Hospital appeals to the Administrative Review Board. And there's a bit of a tortured, you know, history of Florida Hospital here. So again, you see November 2010, the ALJ finds the hospital is a subcontractor. Florida Hospital appeals to the ARP. January 2012, Congress passes the National Defense Authorization Act, and President Obama signs it. Now, what was important about that, the NADA, is that it included a provision, which was Section 715, that specifically addressed the OFCCP's assertion of jurisdiction over TRICARE providers. So most people viewed Section 715 as intending to foreclose any assertions of the OFCCP jurisdiction based solely on TRICARE. Not surprisingly, however, OFCCP had a different interpretation of that provision. So in order to continue asserting its jurisdiction over Florida hospitals, the OFCCP noted it has jurisdiction over two types of subcontracts based on the definition of subcontract in the regulations. The first prong defines subcontracts as any agreement or arrangement between a contractor and any person for the purchase, sale, or use of personal property or non-personal services, which is necessary to the performance of one or more covered government contracts. The second prong defines subcontract as any agreement or arrangement between a contractor and any person under which a portion of the contractor's obligations covered by government contract is performed or undertaken or assumed. So the OFCCP admitted that Section 715 of the NADA barred it from arguing that a provider has entered into a covered subcontract based on that second prong. But OFCCP has taken the position that it does not bar it from asserting jurisdiction over a TRICARE participant based on that first prong. So what happened here, you then have in July 2013, the Administrative Review Board, based on the OFCCP's interpretation of NADA on reconsideration, finds that Florida Hospital is a subcontractor, but there is some language in there, not sure if it qualifies as federal financial assistance, which doesn't really drive the case, didn't really drive the case anyway. So of course, that gets appealed one more time. March 2014, the Secretary of the Department of Labor affirmed the decision finding Florida Hospital is a subcontractor. And, of course, panic ensues among the TRICARE subcontractors. And in response to that panic, a five-year moratorium on enforcement of OFCCP jurisdiction for TRICARE subcontractors is issued. So that brings us to this five-year TRICARE moratorium. So what might be one of the most misunderstood actions taken by both the DOL and the OFCCP, the moratorium for TRICARE subcontractors is a moratorium on enforcement of OFCCP jurisdiction, not a moratorium on compliance by subcontractors with their affirmative action obligations. So on May 7, 2014, the OFCCP used its prosecutorial discretion to self-limit any enforcement activities against TRICARE subcontractors by issuing the moratorium for a period of 5 years. So at that point, on May 7, 2014, it closed existing compliance reviews and agreed to provide technical assistance for those affected organizations. The moratorium, it should be, I want to be really clear, the moratorium does not apply if you are a prime contractor with TRICARE. If you have are a Tricare subcontractor who also has separate subcontractors with other federal agencies. The moratorium also does not apply to OFCCP investigating any complaints that come in from employees under EO-11246, Section 503, or VEVRAA. So we got a question here. What's the distinction between a federal contract and federal financial assistance, or is it the same?
Well, federal financial assistance, an example, could be a grant.
Right.
Grants, the types of strings that are attached to a contract. I mean, a contract usually is, it's a two-way street. You're doing something, you're getting paid for it, there's lots of conditions, there's billing. A grant has a different set of rules. And often in the nonprofit arena, they're governed under a different set of rules. So, for instance, the Department of Defense contracts governed or under the DoD FAR, that lists a number of provisions, whereas OMB regulates other types of nonprofit grants and programs that are not contracts. So there is a difference. Financial assistance could be in the form of an SBA loan, small business. So there's a number of ways that the government gives financial assistance that doesn't necessarily make someone a government contractor. So I think that's where the first step in this analysis is, do you meet the various definitions? And you could satisfy the definition under the OFCCP to be a government contractor and technically not meet it under a different set of statutes. So I think it's also understanding in what circumstances you evaluated the question.
So the moratorium is for 5 years. It is set to expire on May 7, 2019, 600 days away. Who's counting? The OFCCP has continued to focus on the healthcare industry. In the past 6 months alone, I have had at least four clients, all hospital systems, who have received audit letters from the OFCCP, not related to any TRICARE subcontract. So there is a good chance that this focus will actually ramp up when the moratorium ends in less than 2 years. And that's, again, we don't have a crystal ball. That is assuming it will be lifted, but that's not a given right now under the current administration. However, at this point, we have no indication that it won't be lifted. There has been nothing coming from the administration or from the Department of Labor that it won't be lifted in May of 2019.
And Jen, it's funny that I think both you and I are both seeing a type of pattern for where these come up. It could be a large entity who gets a notice and doesn't know that one of its subsidiaries has a small $10,000 contract with somebody or a small two-person service agreement. It tends to be some kind of buried issue. However, once they start to look into it, they find that they have multiple government-type contracts. So It does seem to be the kind of thing that, people tend to say, I define myself as a government contractor if that's, they think of the traditional, defense contractors, and they're not really thinking about how easy it is to trigger these requirements.
Yeah, and so in our opinion, if you are a TRICARE subcontractor, now is probably the time to start working on coming into compliance, considering you have a little less than 2 years to get that process established and ready. The OFCCP has jurisdiction for a two-year look back, which means when they come with an audit letter or a compliance evaluation letter, they can request all information or records that you have showing you've been in compliance for the 2 years prior. And like we've been saying, the moratorium is a moratorium on enforcement, not a moratorium on compliance, which means OFCCP expects that organizations covered by the moratorium have been spending this time getting themselves in compliance to be ready for enforcement when the moratorium gets lifted. So it needs to be careful that you aren't caught flat-footed when the moratorium does get lifted.
Well, it seems like we're lighting up the question board, Jen.
Yeah, so the one we just got in is, our audit notices public record, and is there a way for us to know whether they are auditing healthcare organizations in our area?
I'm not sure the answer to that. Obviously, these kind of records, when an investigation is closed, may be the subject of FOIA. I don't know if these would fall under the various law enforcement exemptions of FOIA or not, but I think there's always a risk that these, at least the requests subject to the various FOIA redactions, would be the kind of thing that someone could request and the government would decide. Now, I think there's a lot of healthcare and other type things that are in these responses that would be withheld, but I think you should act on the presumption that this stuff could be in the public, could be out there. Whether or not it is or not, I think you need to be sensitive to the idea that they could be made available to the public.
Right.
I don't know an answer for sure, though, as to what type of protections there would be from FOIA requests and things like that.
So moving on from Tricare, are you a covered contractor? Do you have a contract with the VA, the DOD, the HHS, the DHS? If you have any contract with a federal government agency, you are a federal contractor or federal subcontractor. Now, depending on your size as an employer and the size of the contract, will determine whether or not you have affirmative action obligations, but you are, at the end of the day, a federal contractor or subcontractor. So here's just a quick chart that's a helpful kind of cheat sheet for determining whether you are covered as it relates to Medicare, Medicaid, and Tricare. Medicaid, if all you have is a Medicaid contract or subcontract, you are not covered. Same for Medicare Parts A and B. Medicare Parts C and D, you probably are. It hasn't been very well tested yet, but my assessment is that, yes, you probably are. And again, Tricare network provider, yes. If you're a non-network provider for Tricare, no.
Jen, one of the areas that's all the other federal healthcare programs where this may come up, I think obviously the first case or one of the cases in your trilogy, the OPM's healthcare system for federal employees is a common area where you see participants. Another one is the VA, where I think the VA tends to be a place where we see some of these small contracts, because the VA often is in areas that they have not enough services available to meet the population, so they contract that out. And that's obviously one of the fixes to the waits at things like the VA. So there's a lot of smaller support contracts around VA hospitals. Even in Baltimore, our VA hospital co-works with the University of Maryland Medical Center quite a bit. So I think the VA is another one where I would be very particular about looking in your records for potential contracts.
And here's actually an excellent question. So if the prime contractor is covered and requires an affirmative action plan, are all lower tier subcontractors required to have an affirmative action plan if they perform services required by the government contract, even if the sub is a single person or receiving less than $50,000? So the short answer is going to be yes. If that subcontractor, if the lower tier is performing services required by the government contract, then you are going to be a subcontractor, but you likely are not going to be required to actually have an affirmative action plan. You will have affirmative action obligations. So, for example, you will need to comply with Executive Order 11246 by not discriminating against individuals based on their race, religion, national origin, things like that. But you probably would not have to have an affirmative action plan, which is the next step up, because you only, for example, if you only have one person or you have less than 50 employees. Same for if you have 50 or more employees, but you're receiving less than $50,000. If your contract is less for 50, your subcontract is less than $50,000, then you are not required to have an affirmative action plan.
Jen, is my understanding that if you say you're the parent, though, and you have multiple small subs, do you aggregate them in deciding whether or not the parent meets the threshold?
Sure. So the difference is, if you have a parent who has if you have a parent who has a subcontract with a government agency or with a prime, and you reach the threshold for the number of employees and the amount of the contract, if you have any of your subsidiaries who are also performing work under that contract, then yes, the subsidiaries would also be covered or required to have affirmative action plans. But not necessarily. It really depends. If it's the parent that has the contract or the relationship, then the subsidiaries don't necessarily get covered. However, if you have a subsidiary that's performing the work and the subsidiary has a parent or other subsidiaries who meet that 26-point single entity test, then the obligations for affirmative action actually flow upward or sideways to other subsidiaries or up to the parent, depending on whether you have common ownership, common control, common officers and directors, common personnel policies. So you'd have to look at where the commonalities mm-hmm. lie between other subsidiaries and your parents.
And I would think that even if I'm the parent or the main entity and I have a number of subsidiaries and each one of my subsidiaries has a small contract that maybe in and of itself doesn't meet the threshold, but if I'm the parent owning all those, I'm counted, all those together count towards me at that point, probably, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Which brings us to our next poll question. Has your organization ever received an evaluation or audit letter from the OFCCP? Or have you gotten an on-site evaluation from the OFCCP? Any of those, actually. Let's see what we got here. All right, we have about 14% have had one within the last year and 7% within the last 5 years, and 42% don't know. Okay, so if you have federal contracts or federal subcontracts and you are in the potential scope of OFCCP jurisdiction, then you need to start considering developing an affirmative action plan. So if you're covered, you must have a plan for each of your covered establishments, and that plan must be, quote, acceptable, which is not a term that's been defined. So there's a lot of play within that. And there are a lot of different creative ways of creating an affirmative action plan that makes sense for your business. But it really comes down to there is no one plan that fits all. You really have to come up with something that works, that's unique to you and makes sense for how your organization runs. Generally, you have to have in your plan a selection procedures that ensure equal opportunity for all qualified applicants, and the plan should set up to compare the percentages of minorities and females in the organization's workforce to census data, and you are going to be expected to use that data to see if there are any deficiencies and to correct those disparities between the workforce and your census data. So talk about some developments with OFCCP. This one's a little bit old, but just so you know, February 2013, Directive 307 was issued, and it addresses pay discrimination by looking at summary compensation data by groupings based on pay ranges or job groups. Auditors who are going to be looking at this area will be looking for the size of the overall pay differences as well as the size of the largest pay difference with different job groups. More recently, August 2016, a final rule on sex discrimination was issued, and that took effect August 25th of 2016. And it is unique to other federal rules and regulations because it defines the term because of sex, so discrimination because of sex, to include gender identity, transgender status, and sex stereotyping. So it requires organizations to allow transgender employees to use the bathroom of the gender with which they identify. It also requires fair pay practices and prohibits discrimination because of pregnancy. And finally, probably most controversially, it requires coverage for healthcare services to be made available on the same terms for all individuals for whom those services are medically appropriate, regardless of their sex assigned at birth or their gender identity or their recorded gender. So, for example, where a transgender man needs medical treatment for ovarian cancer, a contractor may not deny coverage based on that individual's identification as male. And then most recently, which when I say most recently, I'm talking about Monday of this week, the Senate Appropriations Committee rejected the White House's proposal to merge OFCCP into the EEOC. The White House had proposed this as part of its budget approximately a month ago. The business community came out in very strong opposition to that proposed merger. But the Senate committee did recommend cutting the OFCCP's budget and strongly urged the agency to find efficiencies and cost savings. And it also instructed OFCCP to provide an inventory of its current infrastructure and a plan to consolidate and, quote, right-size the agency. So right now, OFCCP has approximately 550 full-time employees, and the committee has indicated that it expects it to reduce its employment population by a little more than 100, down to around 420 or 430 full-time employees. So those are the updates, which brings us to Tom.
Great. Well, you know, one of the things to think about as we talk about this, when you talk about all these, obviously the affirmative action requirements, I'm going to mention, in addition to the affirmative action requirements, government contracts contain a number of other labor and employment-related kind of special requirements that often are incorporated into government contract language. And we'll talk about some of those. I'm going to use some examples that kind of go beyond simply the affirmative action plan, but it's something for people to think about. Why does this matter? Because there's a couple of reasons that I want to focus on. One is that there's sanctions and penalties that the Department of Labor, through the OFCCP or the Office of Labor and Management Standards, sanctions and penalties they can impose that can be very significant to businesses, as well as what I'm going to talk about, False Claims Act liability. When you deal in the government contract space, you're always thinking not just about contract breach remedies, but also about Office of Inspector General investigations. So if you've worked at all with the Department of Labor, you understand that they have various program-type agencies like OFCCP, Wage and Hour. They also have their Office of Inspector General that has both civil and criminal enforcement capabilities, which can significantly change the dynamic of any investigation. So I included here a section from one of the CFRs. This deals with a different executive order, 13496, which deals with the notices under the National Labor Relations Act. This is just an example of some of the powers that these OFCCP has. They're not a prosecution agency like you think of, like Department of Justice, but they can direct a contracting agency to essentially, if they're not meeting the requirements, to terminate the contract, to essentially debar them, or to, not just debar them for that agency, but for any agency. So there's a whole spectrum of consequences associated with these requirements. And I think Jen can give some more examples. They don't issue specifically money penalties like you might see in a court case. But what they do is they issue consent decrees, or they seek consent decrees and issue restitution orders, where if someone has not been selected for promotion, or because of a faulty affirmative action plan, there may be requirements OFCCP imposes on a company to make restitution or remedy that situation. Jen, can you think of any examples of what I'm talking about there, or more detail on the types of things they might do to an employer?
Yeah, I mean, you're looking at the potential for having to pay back wages, front pay, And really the OFCCP is a compliance focused organization. So, you know, for as it relates to that, they're looking, they want you more to come into compliance. But really, the penalties that you're going to be seeing are, like I said, any wages that didn't get paid out that they've, you know, fine that should have been paid either to individuals who weren't employed or individuals who were let go or weren't promoted. Mm-hmm. That's the kind of thing that you're going to be seeing as far as penalties from OFCCP at least.
Yeah, and I think that the ultimate penalty, the ultimate hammer they hold is if you're not in compliance with this term, they can push a contracting agency to basically not to terminate the contract.
Right.
I think that's the real, that threat is designed to force compliance.
That's the ultimate. It would be what's called debarment, which would be you'd be barred essentially from for a period of time that they would determine from being a federal contractor or subcontractor, and you would actually have to report that debarment going forward for a certain period of time once even the debarment is lifted. So that would be the ultimate. It would be keeping you from being a federal contractor or subcontractor.
So the next category of stuff that I want to make sure everyone's aware of, and this isn't a huge threat, but there's a couple reasons why you have to think about it. One is, in government contracts, you typically file invoices to get paid, otherwise you're not going to be able to get paid. Every contract and every government agency has their own language in these invoices. A couple contracts I've looked at in the healthcare space included provision that says, on every invoice, it must include the language that, in submitting this invoice, I'm certifying that I've met with and satisfied all material terms of the contract or conditions, or other language like that. So why is that significant? The significance because if the certification or the, as it here, implied certification of these invoices is that you have met with material terms of the contract, and the government ever takes the position that having the affirmative action plan, having these other requirements, I'll give some examples, are material terms that are essential in order to pay the invoice, not simply just part of the contract, but as part of being the invoice paid, and it's construed that the contractor falsely certified they were in compliance, you're not only eligible now for a breach of contract, but you'd be eligible for penalties per claim of up to over $20,000, in addition to three times the amount of the value of the contract as damages, as well as other types of penalties we can talk about. However, why this is significant is, as OFCCP, either, you know, these terms become more well known, False Claims Act liability is often pushed by the plaintiff's bar, or what's called the relator's bar. And it only takes one case in one district to be brought by a relator asserting these types of false certification claims to make it kind of a catch of interest to the relator bar. By the way, I say relator, for those of you who are not aware, a relator is a person who brings what's called a quitam action under the False Claims Act, where they bring the action on behalf of the government and then are entitled to a percentage of any proceeds of the settlement or eventual litigation. A reverse false claim is where the theory is that in making representations to the government, a contractor has omitted material things or facts or information that would have stopped them from getting paid, or that they know that they are supposed to be giving money or not taking money, and they fail to inform the government as such. So there's a number of ways. So for instance, you as a government contractor may have gotten a notice that you're out of compliance. You have no intention or have not started getting compliance, yet you continue then to file your invoices certifying that you're in compliance. That would be a classic example of a type of a false claim situation that may pose some risk. Now, I have done some searching and not found an example of a reported case where someone has tried such a False Claims Act case, but there's a lot of consequences that I think people should be sensitive to. So what can you do? Couple thoughts. If you're, you know, I call it what I call dabbling in government contract land. I mean, most of the healthcare business is not government contracts. Most of the healthcare money is in the private sector, third-party payers, et cetera. And sometimes individual offices may do a small amount of government contracting. if you're going to do that and an agency really wants you for some reason, it's a necessity, it's an underserved area in the country, do your best to negotiate either moratoriums on enforcement, certain things to try and put into the contract. Now, those aren't always successful, but it's one of your best ways to avoid certain types of liability. If you can come to an agreement with the government that, oh, we're not required to do this, we're not required to do that. Second is to seek exemptions, and I'm going to talk about some of the exemptions, but when you go through these government contracts, there are, every one of the requirements has a process by which you exemption. But the most important one we'll focus on in a minute is this affirmative action. Lastly, there's also things to do to try and limit applicability within the organization. And of course, if all else fails, you just got to spend the time and energy to get into compliance. Next one. Some of these negotiation strategies, really know what you're signing up for before you bid on a reward or an award. Ask the question. Incorporate, and then think about it before you make your proposal. How much is it going to cost to get into compliance, and make sure you incorporate that into your proposal so that your overhead is a fair description of what's going to be involved. Next. So in exemption authorities, if you look under in the Equal Opportunity, 41 CFR 60.1.5, it talks about several exemptions. And I didn't list them all here, but there's a couple that, you know, you may want to consider if you're going to do this. Facilities not connected with the contracts. In national interest. Those are two examples. Keep in mind, though, all these requests go to typically the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Labor. Typically, someone in the Department of Labor is the approval authority. So even though your contract may be with Tricare, Defense, or somewhere else, it's someone in the Department of Labor who's typically the approval authority. Next. Another one that we typically see in these is the minimum wage requirements. This is another way you can try and limit applicability through good management. They usually have percent of work before these types of minimum wage requirements are applied. So through effective planning and management of how personnel are used on a particular contract, you may be able to avoid triggering certain minimum wage requirements. These are just examples, but there's things like this in a number of the government contract requirements. Next slide. Okay.
So if anybody has any questions, we can see them in our Q&A box that you're typing in. So please be sure to send us those in. Or if you want to if you think of something later and want to email either Tom or myself, our email addresses were at the front of the presentation. And finally, I just want to let you know this is going to be a bi-monthly webinar series. So the next session is going to be on November 9th, conducting internal investigations in hospitals and other healthcare facilities. And then next year, January 11th, we're going to be presenting what hospitals should do in an active shooter situation. So I hope that you're able to attend our future sessions. Please RSVP at that website or that email address there. And thank you for joining us, and we hope to hear from you soon.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.